Dear YouTube, as you know, under copyright law, I am allowed to use portions of copyrighted material, in this case, copyrighted material belonging to the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society of Pennsylvania, so long as this is used for the purpose of criticism and parody. Please remember this when Watchtower comes complaining because I've embarrassed them by using their propaganda in a way they disapprove of. Thank you. Hello there. Well, I really wasn't expecting to make this video, but last night I turned on JW Broadcasting, the tv.jw.org website, and one of the most recent videos uploaded is by governing body helper Ken Flodin, who some of you will remember from the bread illustration.
We sadden him. We grieve the spirit.
And Brother Flodin was giving us comments from part of a morning worship at Bethel, and the theme of the video is beware of deceit. Now, he's reading from the Bible Book of Jude, and he's basically applying what he's reading to apostates. And obviously not just apostates as the Bible writers would have meant, the Bible writers would have had in mind people who denied Christ or what have you. No, Watchtower's view of apostates or someone who is an apostate is anybody basically who turns their back on Jehovah's Witnesses. So Brother Flodin sets out to make the argument that apostates, as predicted in the Bible book, of Jude, are deceitful.
Look at 16. These men are murmurers, complainers, following their own desires, making grandiose boasts while they're flattering others for their own benefit. Excuse me. So he's really describing the traits of apostates today, isn't he?
If you say so, Ken. Brother Flodin then goes on to give a rather rambling dissertation about Michael the Archangel grappling with Satan over Moses' body. Too tedious to go into in any great detail, but then he gets more to the point by reminding his audience of the need to respect the authority of the faithful and discreet slave, in other words, the governing body.
Michael set a good example of not overstepping authority. And that becomes an equally a good lesson for us today to know the limits of our authority and responsibility. And unlike those rebellious ones in Jude's day, we don't want to be rebellious. Instead, we want to follow the lead of the faithful slave, be content to do that. The slave that Michael, our Lord Christ Jesus, is using today.
Don't be rebellious, be content, know your limits. These are all the sort of things that you would expect to hear from an organization that absolutely insists on its authority being unquestioned. And what better way to reinforce Watchtower's authority than to demonize apostates as being evil, wicked, and deliberately deceitful?
Well, here's a question. Are apostates today as reprehensible as those ones that Jude mentioned in his short letter? Are they devious? Or maybe they're sincerely trying to help poor, misguided witnesses. No, they're devious. Have you ever noticed that apostates generally do not try to reason from the scriptures?
How are Jehovah's Witnesses supposed to notice anything about apostates if they are directly prohibited from listening to anything apostates have to say?
Why not? Because they know we know the scriptures and we would see through the twisting.
This itself is a total lie. When I'm writing JW survey articles, I will frequently quote from the scriptures because even though I don't happen to be a believer anymore, it still just so happens that the Bible and Christianity in general is in direct conflict with many of the grossly unchristian teachings of the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. And all you need to do to prove how wrong Ken Flodin is here is pick up a copy of Crisis of Conscience and see how much Ray Franz quoted from the Bible, or go on JWfacts and see how much Paul Grundy quotes directly from the New World Translation to reinforce the point that the teachings and practices and policies of Watchtower aren't just grossly harmful and negligent, they're also actually infringing against the very book that Watchtower supposedly stands for.
Instead, they pick at the organization, they twist truth, they use lies, half-truths, to try to grab a mind.
I can be lectured by just about anybody when it comes to the need for honesty and not twisting facts, but I will not be lectured by anybody who has any role of responsibility within Watchtower. Ken Flodin is a total hypocrite. There is an entire article on JWfacts devoted to lies and misquotes, deliberate misquotes in Watchtower publications designed to give a completely false impression of what is the case. And we had an example of this only as recently as the January 2015 Awake magazine. And this is the January 2015 Awake magazine, the title of which, How Did Life Begin, would have been more accurate if it instead read, Why the Scientific Consensus is Wrong About Evolution and a Bunch of Guys in New York Know Better. Anyway, if you go to jw.org and download this magazine, you will see that this is what page 3 now looks like. I say now looks like because it hasn't always looked like this. Originally, it looked like this. As you will notice, the difference between the new version on the left and the original on the right is that the original featured a quote from Rama Singh, a professor of biology at Canada's McMaster University. Singh is quoted as saying, "The opposition to evolution goes beyond religious fundamentalism and includes a great many people from educated sections of the population." Unfortunately, when you look up Singh's paper from which this quote is taken, you quickly discover that it is, in fact, a misquote. Singh concludes the same paragraph by saying, "There are several reasons why facts of evolution are not easily comprehensible by the general masses." In other words, the premise of Singh's paper was not that evolution is false, but that something needs to be done about the fact that not enough people understand it. Soon after The Awake came out, Singh was approached to see whether he was happy with how he had been misquoted in a magazine attacking evolution. He was not. Indeed, he felt so strongly about it that he wrote an open letter to The Awake editor demanding that the quote be removed and an unconditional apology printed. Curiously, the same letter is no longer available where the professor first posted it, but a full copy of it can be read on the XJW site, taze.co, and before it was taken down, it was quoted on neutral websites such as The Friendly Atheist and Inquisitor.com. To give you a taste of what Singh had to say, here are just two quotes from Inquisitor.com. "I have received inquiries from many evolutionists, atheists, and former members of your organization, XJW, who brought the above misquotation to my attention. I agree with them that your misquotation of my work is deliberate and meant to convince your followers in the truth of creationism by perpetuating false support from scientists. So I am asking you first to remove the misquotation from your article immediately, and second, print an unconditional apology for what I consider is a deliberate damaging action on your part to my reputation." Singh is also quoted saying, "If I may suggest, as an organization, you should stop wasting your time in perpetuating lies against evolution." Though Watchtower did remove the quote from digital versions, as you might expect, no public apology was ever issued to Professor Singh. Instead, Watchtower just hopes no witnesses will notice that it got caught red-handed deliberately taking the words of a scientist in support of its anti-evolution stance, which incidentally is a trick Watchtower writers repeatedly pulled when the now out-of-print Blue Creation book was being written. The deliberate and willful deception of Watchtower's writing department is just mind-boggling. And as another example of Watchtower's blatant lying to Jehovah's Witnesses, Who could forget this video uploaded to JW Broadcasting in February 2015, in which Stephen Lett flatly denies that the organization has any problem at all with child abuse?
Another way we can contribute to the oneness, rejecting false stories that are designed to separate us from Jehovah's organization. As an example, think about the apostate-driven lies and dishonesties that Jehovah's organization is permissive toward pedophiles. I mean, that is ridiculous, isn't it? If anybody takes action against someone who would threaten our young ones and takes action to protect our young ones, it's Jehovah's organization. We reject outright such lies.
Contrast that with what Jeffrey Jackson had to say on the same subject when questioned at the Australian Royal Commission by Angus Stewart.
I accept that child abuse is a problem right throughout the community, and it's something that we've had to deal with as well. There have been changes in policies over the last 20 or 30 years where we've tried to address some of those problem areas, and by the fact that we've changed the policy would indicate that the original policies weren't perfect.
And you accept, of course, that your organisation, including people in positions of responsibility like elders, are not immune from the problem of child sexual abuse?
That appears to be the case.
So straight away you have one governing body member saying there is no problem with child abuse, and another governing body member saying, yes, there might be a problem with child abuse even though we're on top of it. It's either one or the other. But when it comes to giving Jehovah's Witnesses information, bear in mind that most witnesses won't be aware of Jeffrey Jackson's appearance at the Royal Commission. When it comes to information that Jehovah's Witnesses get access to, they are given a completely false image of what the organisation is and how it handles itself. It is grossly hypocritical of Watchtower to accuse apostates of lying when books could be written about all of the instances in which Jehovah's Witnesses have been fed false information by the organization that they look up to as being spokespersons for God.
Well, are they deceitful? Absolutely. Here's an example. I worked in writing correspondence many years ago, and they get letters from everyone that has our address. And sometimes those letters are from ones who have been fed apostate information. And one example I came through in my stack of letters, it was a sincere older lady, it seemed, by the look of the scrawl of her handwriting. It was probably an older woman. And she sent in a photocopy from a page of a 1910 Watchtower. And her question is, why did your Mr. Russell say that you only need to read his book, Studies in the Scriptures, instead of the Bible? Well, I read over the photocopy, and it looks like that's exactly what it said. But then I got an original, the 1910 magazine, and compared, and very quickly you could discern the deceit, the trickery that was involved. When photocopying that page, they put a piece of white paper over the bottom part of the page so that you didn't see the bottom of the first column. And they were very tricky. They placed it exactly on a line where it sounded like, when reading down the first column, that the sentence completed on the second column. Well, what was in the first part of that column that they had made invisible with the paper? It was a subheading, Scripture Studies, Not a Substitute for the Bible. And here's what it said in that text that was disappeared with their photocopying. It says, this is not therefore putting Scripture Studies as a substitute for the Bible, because so far as substituting for the Bible, the studies, on the contrary, continually refer to the Bible. And if anyone has any doubt as to a reference, or if one's recollection should lapse in any degree, one should refresh his memory and, in fact, should see that his every thought is in harmony with the Bible, not merely in accord with Scripture Studies, but in accord with the Bible. Now, why would someone do that? They doctored the page because of deceit and trickery. There was no sincere effort to help that dear old lady who received the copy.
Now, I happen to have here a printout of the 1910 Watchtower article, It's actually goes across three pages, quite a long, rather tedious in places article. But I instantly wanted to check it. Now, the first thing to notice is that we have no way of knowing whether his claims that the article was doctored can be validated. When you print out these old Watchtower pages, I mean, this is A4. In America, you guys will use letter style paper. When you print them out onto a single page, the writing is very small. So if you're going to blow the text up so that it can be easily read, for example, for the purpose of correspondence, you're inevitably going to crop out text. That could be what happened here. Or it could be that the old sister was sent a photocopy that deliberately blanked out part of the article. We have no way of knowing because Ken Flodin isn't showing us, as he could easily do, the letter that he was sent. But even in that worst case scenario, if we give it to Ken Flodin that there was a deliberate attempt at deception here, even if we make that concession, there are two main problems. Firstly, just because one apostate somewhere with his photocopier decided to deceive someone, that does not by itself mean that all apostates are deceptive. You simply cannot give one anecdote to make such a sweeping generalization about anybody, past, present, or future, who has left or will leave Jehovah's Witnesses, that they will become deceptive. The second point worth making is that if you actually read this article, you notice that Ken Flodin is himself being deceptive if he honestly expects us to believe that that one portion that he read under the heading Scripture Studies, Not a Substitute for the Bible, if he expects us to believe that that exonerates the article itself, it doesn't by any stretch of the imagination. I'm now going to, as quickly and concisely as possible, let you know exactly what nonsense this article contains and how it really does suggest that the Scripture Studies, the studies in the Scriptures that Charles Taze Russell wrote and distributed, it really was expected that they were supposed to be the go-to place for Bible study and not so much the Bible itself. Allow me to read to you from the opening paragraph, and I will put a graphic up so that you can read along. And by all means, download the magazine itself. You can download the entire bound volume if you follow the links in the description. So anyway, the article begins by saying, "The plan of reading 12 pages of the studies in the Scriptures each day, tried by so many, results in more Bible study than any other way that we know of. We believe that it is not so much the time that is given to Bible study, but the amount of study done and the amount of information gained that counts. We all know people who have spent days and weeks and years in study of the Bible and have learned little or nothing. We think the idea that Bible study is merely the time spent in handling a Bible and reading over some verses is a mistaken idea." Now, you might be wondering, why am I bringing up this? Well, apart from it being the opening paragraph, so it gives us some idea of the tone of the article, what's interesting here is that the writers of the Watchtower are saying that it's a good thing to read studies in the Scriptures, the six volumes at that point of studies in the Scriptures, 12 pages of it every day. They're saying that's a good idea. In fact, they say it's results in more Bible study than any other way that we know of. So try and keep that in mind as I read you other quotes, that Watchtower is saying that reading studies in the Scriptures to that degree is a good thing. Now, the next part I'm going to read you is on the disputed page. Now, this is the page that Ken Flodin quotes from, and you'll see the part in green there is the part that Ken Flodin reads. I'm going to try and not read too much, but I just do want to, you know, put you in the picture as to what this article was telling witnesses of that time, because it has been grossly misrepresented by Ken Flodin. The article goes on, Therefore, the simplest way to explain the matter is to acknowledge that the Lord's due time has come and that he has guided to the right understanding. If, then, the Lord has provided us with something in our day that other days than those of the apostles knew nothing about, no matter how good nor how wise they were, for us to ignore the line of teaching which has been thus developed would be, in our judgment, to ignore the Lord's providences. It is for each one to think for himself, however, and to guide his conduct in every way accordingly. Now, what it's saying there is that because they considered themselves to be living in the Lord's time, they considered Jesus to be guiding their understanding of Scripture. And therefore, if you ignored their teachings or Charles Taze Russell's teachings, you were ignoring the Lord's providence. So that's another thing we need to take into account. That's the gravity with which Charles Taze Russell viewed his own teachings, that they were given to him by Jesus because they were living in a time of great significance. Now, the next quote is the quote that's most often referred to when this article is quoted, and I assume it's the quote that the sister sent to Watchtower that Ken Flodin is using for his example of apostate dishonesty. And it really is very damning. There's two parts to it. If the six volumes of scripture studies are practically the Bible topically arranged with Bible proof texts given, we might not improperly name the volumes the Bible in an arranged form. That is to say, they are not merely comments on the Bible, but they are practically the Bible itself, since there is no desire to build any doctrine or thought on any individual preference or on any individual wisdom, but to present the entire matter on the lines of the Word of God. We therefore think it safe to follow this kind of reading, this kind of instruction, this kind of Bible study. So there you have Watchtower telling witnesses, listen, these books that we've written, the studies in the scriptures, the six volumes of studies in the scriptures, they're basically the Bible, just in a different order. So when you're reading the studies in the scriptures, you're reading the Bible itself. And it says that in completely clear, unambiguous terms in this quote. But, you know, surprise, surprise, Ken Flodin doesn't recite that part of the article. It then goes on to say, furthermore, not only do we find that people cannot see the divine plan in studying the Bible by itself, but we see also that if anyone lays the scripture studies aside, even after he has used them, after he has become familiar with them, after he has read them for 10 years, if he then lays them aside and ignores them and goes to the Bible alone, though he has understood his Bible for 10 years, our experience shows that within 2 years he goes into darkness. On the other hand, if he had merely read the scripture studies with their references and had not read a page of the Bible, as such he would be in the light at the end of the 2 years, because he would have the light of the scriptures. You cannot make this up. Here Charles Taze Russell is telling his readers, or allowing his readers to be told, that if they don't read his books, the studies in the scriptures, they will be in darkness, no matter how much they read the Bible. I mean, it's difficult to imagine a way of Charles Taze Russell emphasizing the importance of his books more strongly than to say, never mind if you read the Bible all the time, you will be in darkness unless you read my books. The article then goes on to talk about the relationship that the studies of the scriptures should have with the Bible. In other words, how someone was supposed to use the studies in the scriptures and the Bible. Were they supposed to verify each and every scripture? Well, it says, well, for the first two times, for the first one or two times, you know, you might want to verify and see for yourself that the scriptures are being fairly quoted and fairly cited and properly cited. But then it says, if after doing that we should find the books to be in accord with the Bible, then we would think we were logical in saying, I will not need to go through that process now every time that I read the scripture studies, for I have looked up those texts of scriptures and know certainly that the New Testament proves all those points. So what he's saying there is that, yes, you might want to use your Bible in your Bible study when you're first verifying, on the first read or the first two reads of studies in the scriptures. But you can actually, in theory, reach a stage where you don't need to read your Bible at all, because you've already confirmed that those verses are indeed correctly quoted. Now, for the sake of completeness, it does say, if at the same time in any future reading we should come to a place where something did not seem clear to us, and we thought of some scripture which seemed not as harmonious with it as we had previously thought, we would think it our duty to refer at once to the scriptures, because the scriptures are the standard. And in that reference to the scripture, it would be with a view to discerning whether or not we had been mistaken in our previous examination. So he kind of gives this platitude that the scriptures are the standard. But when you read everything else that's said about the fact that if you read only the Bible, you'll be in darkness, and if you ignore the studies in the scriptures altogether, you're ignoring the Lord's providence, because it's Jesus who's been instrumental in giving this new wisdom. When you read everything in context, that line there about the scriptures being the standard, and the part that Ken Flodin quotes from about the scriptures not being a substitute for the Bible, it's all semantics. It's all a moot point, because you've already painted this scenario in which people should be dependent on what you've written as being the final word on what the Bible should mean. Now, the next part I want to read to you is under the heading, "They shall be all taught of God." Now, this is significant in terms of the way the organisation is now, because many of you will remember, I mean, obviously Watchtower is moving out of Brooklyn now, and you might remember not so long ago when they were moving out of some of the factory buildings, they took down a sign that said, "Read God's Word, the Holy Bible, daily." And that's been a mantra and continues to be a mantra for Jehovah's Witnesses. You are supposed to read the Bible every day. If you're a really good, really loyal, really zealous witness, that's the way it is now. It's not the way it was in Russell's day, and I'm going to prove it to you. We would conclude practically that we could not understand anything about the Bible except as it was revealed. We would therefore not waste a great deal of time doing what we know some people do, reading chapter after chapter to no profit. We would not think of doing it. We would not think we were studying the scriptures at all. We would think we were following the course that had been anything but profitable to ourselves and many others in the past, merely reading over the scriptures. We would say that the same Heavenly Father who had guided us to this truth, to this understanding of the scriptures as his children, if he had some further information for us, he would bring it to our attention in some manner, and therefore we would not see the necessity of reading the New Testament every day or every year. We would not consider that necessary. That is completely at odds with the way the organisation tells witnesses to conduct their study arrangements now. It's supposed to be, as I've said, that witnesses read the Bible every day. But the Bible is so relegated in importance in this article that, as we've read before, the studies in the scriptures, it's okay to read 12 pages a day. In fact, it's a good thing to read 12 pages of studies in the scriptures every day. But reading the Bible every day, or even, as it says, every year, is considered not necessary and a waste of time. So now, hopefully, we're starting to understand why Ken Flodin hasn't read more of this article, which, as you can see, as I mentioned before, he only read the green part, not everything else. So the next quote I want to share with you, it says, "Why should we attempt to preach or teach anything that we do not understand? So after God favors us in this time with an understanding of present truth, there's that phrase, present truth, that Russell used. It's either true or it isn't. It shouldn't matter whether it's present or not. He has given us a knowledge of more truth than we could have gained in 1,000 years if we had read and studied unaided. And now we can attempt to present it to others. So there is another slight, another attempt at Russell to patronise those who would want to read the Bible on a daily basis. He's saying, listen, you could read the Bible for 1,000 years and you're not going to come up with the truth the way I've come up with the truth. If you really want to learn about the Bible, you're going to have to read my studies in the scriptures. You're not going to find truth from God by reading by yourself, not if it takes you 1,000 years. So then we have that green part that Ken Flodin read about scripture studies not a substitute for the Bible. And really, it's just it's a red herring that's presented, because it just basically says, this is not therefore putting the scripture studies as a substitute for the Bible, because so far as substituting for the Bible, the studies, on the contrary, continually refer to the Bible. So what they're saying is, well, you can't say it's a substitute for the Bible because we use the Bible, we quote from the Bible. But that isn't an argument. That doesn't negate everything else that we've just read, that's saying if you don't read studies in the scriptures, you're going to be in the dark. You could read the Bible for 1,000 years and you're not going to come up with the wisdom we've come up with. If you ignore studies in the scriptures, you're ignoring Jesus, you're ignoring the Lord's providence. That just that paragraph doesn't dismantle everything that's already been said. It just shows an effort on Russell's part to try and, you know, have it both ways and kind of and present it in a more palatable way. Immediately after the part that Ken Flodin read, it's interesting if you read on, it says, we might remark that quite a number of the friends in the truth are making it a rule to read 12 pages of the scripture studies a day, and that we do not know one who has been following this course and making use of the various means of grace the Lord has provided, dawn and testimony meetings and Sunday meetings and pilgrim meetings and the Berean lessons, manna text, etc., who has gone out of the truth. So again, it's saying, well, listen, we don't know of anybody who's been reading 12 pages of studies in the scriptures every day who's gone out of the truth. So if you want to stay in the truth, a good way to do that, or a good way to make sure of that, would be to read studies in the scriptures 12 pages a day. It then goes on to say, we are not wishing in this to say anything against one's poring over chapters that he does not understand and others do not understand, hoping that he might light on some truth. We have no objection to this. He has a perfect right to do so if he wishes. He has a right to spend weeks and years in this way if he chooses. But the chances even then are that when he does light on something, he will have it all wrong. So more patronising rhetoric towards anyone who would dare to go it alone, who would dare to read the Bible on its own terms. They're saying, whatever conclusions you reach, the likelihood is you'll have it all wrong. And finally, the article concludes with another reminder of the importance of reading on a daily basis studies in the scriptures. It says, whoever reads 2 pages of scripture studies each day with the suggested paragraphs connected with those 2 pages would do more scripture studying in that time than he could do by any other method. Whenever he reads these pages and calls the corresponding or connecting scriptures to mind, he is drawing from the whole Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, with practically every page he reads. Now, is it possible to find any other Bible study that would accomplish so much for us in the same time as this would do? If there is, we ought to take it. If there is not, then we have our opinion. So what they're saying in conclusion is that a page of studies in the scriptures is like reading Genesis to Revelation. It's so rich in scriptural, biblical reasoning and wisdom that, you know, you're basically reading more of the Bible through reading scripture studies or studies in the scriptures than if you were reading the Bible itself. Now, having read all that, you might be thinking, wow, were studies in the scriptures really that great? And if they were that great, why are we not still reading studies in the scriptures? Or why do we not at least still have access to studies in the scriptures, for example, on Watchtower Library? Well, here is, I actually have all of the six volumes. I have the seventh volume, Finished Mystery, as well, but that's not really a Russell publication. But this is, I think, my favourite book out of all my studies in the scriptures, because it's one of the best preserved copies that I have. This one dates from, I think I've used this in my videos before as well. This one dates from 1907. And you wouldn't think it looking at it, would you? It looks like it's printed yesterday. But one of my Facebook friends found this for me in a thrift store and posted it to me from America. And I'm very, very grateful. But I just want to read to you a few passages about 1914. Because when this was written, Russell was really banging a drum about 1914. So let me first read to you from page 23. It says, "The time of the end, a period of 115 years from AD 1799 to AD 1914, is particularly marked in the scriptures." So there you have it. The time of the end, according to Russell, in this book that was apparently given to him by wisdom from Jesus. The time of the end began in 1799. The time of the end would end in 1914, which immediately tells you that in 1914 they weren't just expecting bad things to start happening, they were expecting things to come to a conclusion with Armageddon. Page 126. "And the parallelism continues to the full end of the harvest of this dispensation until the overthrow of the professedly Christian kingdoms, really, kingdoms of this world, and the full establishment of the kingdom of God in the earth at AD 1914, the terminus of the times of the Gentiles." So let's repeat. In AD 1914, we were supposed to see, or Russell's followers were supposed to see, the overthrow of the professedly Christian kingdoms, really the kingdoms of this world, and the full establishment of the kingdom of God in the earth. They were supposed to see in 1914. Page 153. "And with the end of AD 1914, what God calls Babylon and what men call Christendom will have passed away, as already shown from prophecy." So there'll be no more Christendom after 1914. Nice to know. Pages 304 and 305. "Behind us are all the prophetic landmarks which point to this time as the most wonderful period in all the history of the world. They have shown us that since 1873, we have been living in the seventh millennium, that the lease of Gentile dominion, the times of the Gentiles, will expire with the year 1914, and that the advent of him whose right it is to take the dominion was due in 1874. Basically, they believed that Christ's second coming back then was in 1874, and he established his kingdom in 1878. And obviously that got changed later on when 1914 came and went, and they had to, you know, juggle things around. Page 362. "Call to mind that the scriptures showed us that the full end of Gentile power in the world and of the time of trouble which brings its overthrow will follow the end of AD 1914, and that sometime before that date, the last members of the Church of Christ will have been changed, glorified." Pages 363 and 364. "But this date, 1910, indicated by the pyramid, seems to harmonize well with the dates furnished by the Bible. It is but 4 years before the full close of the time of trouble, which ends the Gentile times. And when we remember the Lord's words, that the overcomers shall be accounted worthy to escape the severest of the trouble coming upon the world, we may understand the reference to be to the anarchist trouble which will follow October 1914. But a trouble chiefly upon the church may be expected about 1910 AD. At this point, I had better interject and apologise about the deviations between the copy of Thy Kingdom Come that I'm reading and the copy being shown on the screen. I knew when making this video that Watchtower changed the text in post-1914 volumes of Studies in the Scriptures to cover over the fact that Charles Russell's predictions never came true. There is even a Watchtower article, Watchtower March 1st, 1915, page 66, reprints 5649, if you're taking notes, telling Bible students where these alterations are to be made for future editions. What I hadn't considered when making this video is that changes might have been made even earlier. I assumed I could show screen grabs from a PDF scan of an 1891 first edition copy of Russell's Thy Kingdom Come, and it would correspond fully with my 1907 copy. I was wrong. Here, for the sake of completeness, are the differences in the texts I've already shown. On page 362 of the 1891 edition, it says that the end of the time of trouble bringing the overthrow of Gentile power will be in the end of AD 1914. While on page 362 of the 1907 edition, it says these events will follow the end of AD 1914. Clearly by 1907, Russell was getting a little twitchy about his predictions and decided to buy himself a little more time for the overthrow of human governments. Then on page 364 of the 1891 edition, it says that the last members of the body or bride of Christ will have been tested and accepted and will have passed beyond the veil, in other words, converted to spirit form, before the close of AD 1910. The same paragraph, albeit heavily reworded, on page 364 of the 1907 edition, says that a trouble chiefly upon the church, or Russell and his fellow Spirit-anointed Christians, may be expected about 1910 AD. Again, just like Watchtower, to get that little bit more vague as the likelihood of being wrong looms closer. And just as a heads up, here are the differences in the final quote I'm about to read before giving my closing arguments. On page 364 of the 1891 edition, it says that the 4 years from 1910 to the end of 1914 will be quite sufficient for the extreme of all that trouble, for when it reaches its terrible climax, it cannot last long. While on the same page in the 1907 edition, it says that that 4 year period will doubtless be a time of fiery trial upon the church, preceding the anarchy of the world, which cannot last long. So in one book, a 4 year period sees the terrible climax that needs to be cut short, while in a later version, this comes after the 4 year period. Suffice to say, despite pointing the finger at apostates for doctoring its publications, Watchtower has been doing this itself on a huge scale from its earliest beginnings. And incredibly, I know more about the extent to which they've been doing this after finishing this video than I did when I started filming. Now back to the video, and please bear with me while I muddle through that last quote one more time. Also on page 364, the 4 years from 1910 to the end of 1914, indicated thus in the Great Pyramid, will doubtless be a time of fiery trial upon the church, preceding the anarchy of the world, which cannot last long. Hopefully, just with those few quotes that I've read you, you've got the gist as to why Watchtower doesn't make freely available the Studies in the Scriptures anymore. In fact, it stopped making them available as far back as 1927. Why? Because they were so completely bonkers and made false prediction after false prediction after false prediction, to the point where there was just so much that the Watchtower had ejected from its official theology that it had to basically not so much deny knowledge, but hope that no one would do the digging and see for themselves what it was that Charles Taze Russell taught. The point is, that sister who wrote to Watchtower asking genuinely how it could be that Charles Taze Russell held his books as of such great importance compared to the Bible, had every right to ask that question, especially when you consider how crazy the studies in the scriptures were, and the fact that the organisation should really have been emphasising the Bible as being of far more importance than any books that they could put out. It is unimaginably disingenuous of Ken Flodin to cite this particular Watchtower article as evidence of apostates being deceptive, hopefully after the quotes I read you earlier from Thy Kingdom Come in the Studies in the Scriptures series, you now understand how preposterous, how utterly preposterous that 1910 Watchtower article was. And yet, Ken Flodin very deliberately chose just one small part to convey his message, when if he'd read the whole thing in context, it's very obvious that it's painting an entirely different picture. No, in a technical sense, they weren't suggesting that the scripture studies were to replace the Bible, but in every practical sense, that's exactly what they were saying.
Well, the book of Jude is applicable for our view of those today who are like evil rocks hidden below the water.
Ooh, that's a stinging insult. I'm an evil rock hidden below the water. Yeah, that's worse than calling me mentally diseased.
Well, let's end our discussion with a flourish of positive reinforcement from the pen of Jude. In Jude, verses 24 and 25, it says, "Now to the one who is able to guard you from stumbling and to make you stand unblemished in the sight of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, might, and authority for all past eternity and now and into all eternity. Amen."
Amen. Thank you, Ken. But seriously, wow. I've been enraged about this since, like I say, I watched it last night, and I just cannot believe the gall that this guy has to accuse apostates like me of being deceptive when Watchtower has a whole history of quote mining and misleading people in its publications. It isn't apostates like me who are saying, listen, you don't need to worry about looking at old Watchtower publications, just focus on the new ones. Forget about what Russell wrote. Forget about what Rutherford wrote. None of that's relevant. Only focus on what's written in the latest publications. We are not saying that at all. We are saying absolutely do objective, independent research in everything Watchtower has written, because it is all relevant, because Watchtower does purport to be God's organization, handpicked by Christ between 1914 and 1919. Therefore, pretty much anything that is written, either by Watchtower or with the International Bible Students Association printed on the inside cover, anything like that is relevant because it's teaching us about the organisation and about its evolution and about the crazy, crazy things it used to teach, even at the beginning of the organisation's history when it was supposedly picked by Jesus. It teaches us so much, and it's impossible to come to any other conclusion when you do research into Watchtower's historic publications that, hey, this is just another man-made religion or cult, if you want to put it that way. But it is absolutely not apostates who are turning people away from old publications, quite the opposite. It's Watchtower who is doing that. It's Watchtower who is telling people, please don't bother looking at this old light. Only look at our new light. Well, they have every reason to do that, because the minute people start looking at the old stuff, the minute the penny drops, the minute it's obvious what's going on. So I would just encourage any Jehovah's Witness who happens to be watching this video, please never take my word for it. Certainly don't take Ken Flodin's word for it. do your own research, and do your research in Watchtower publications, because that's frankly all you need to figure it all out. But if you do want some kind of whistle-stop tour of all of the lies and subterfuge and misquotes that have appeared in Watchtower publications, a great place to start is the JWfacts article I mentioned earlier. Again, a link will be in the description. Please check it out, and hopefully you will understand why I am just so enraged by the blatant hypocrisy that we've seen in Ken Flodin's morning worship lecture. Now, before I sign off, I just want to say that the past week has been rather difficult. I've actually been in hospital for 4.5 days with a broken arm. And in fact, the reason why I'm only using this hand is because the other hand, let me just show you, is, it's still got the bandage on for the stitches. And frankly, it's got still very limited mobility. And I'm having to come to terms with the fact that I can't pick up Jessica and I can't do the things I used to do. What happened was I was playing football and managed to get the ball, and I was running at goal, and someone decided to take my legs from under me to stop me from scoring, and I fell, and rather than falling on grass, because it was a concrete pitch, I fell on concrete. It was my arm that went to take the blow, and it was my arm that broke. So that's how it happened. But it's come at absolutely the worst possible time, because I have a backlog of videos I was hoping to get out before the end of July, and I'm now absolutely not going to do that. But I have already started work on the JW Broadcasting 21 and 22 rebuttals. I'm hoping to do them more or less back to back. And I'm obviously working hard on getting the Worst Convention Ever series finally finished. It's taking me forever, because honestly, when I started out with the project, I had no idea how much material I would have to work with, and it's just been an overload. In fact, I honestly wouldn't have taken on this series at the beginning if I'd known how much work was involved. But I've started it, so I have to finish it. And apart from all of that, next month, August, I have absolutely committed to finishing my book, and I've even set myself targets of how many words to write each day. Now, this means that the book's going to take priority in August, and the YouTube channel is going to not take priority. It's going to be second in priority. But I'm hoping that I will be able to get the Worst Convention Ever series finished in August, and the remaining JW Broadcasting rebuttal videos done. But it will just mean that, you know, these videos will come out later than I originally intended. Basically, what I'm going to do is my word count for each day will take priority, and then once I've hit that word count, I'll devote a little bit of time to video editing, because it really does take a while, take a long time to make these videos. But I'm not going to abandon them. I am going to finish them. And hopefully, I'm going to also be able to finish my book in August. And when I say finish it, I mean finish the writing. There will still be maybe a month, 2 months, 3 months of getting the editing done and getting things like the index created and all of those sorts of things. But I'm genuinely committed to getting my book finished at least by the winter. So that's what I'm going to focus on next month. So if you don't see as many videos as you would like to in August, I apologise in advance, but that's the reason why. Incidentally, if you're interested in appearing in one of my videos, you have a chance to do that. The final part of the Worst Convention Ever series, part 9, will be a montage of people appearing, showing signs saying, "Freedom is my paradise." Because without giving too much away, Part 8 in the series is actually about a Watchtower video that depicts witnesses in paradise to stirring music. And it's very, very emotional, heart-tugging propaganda that they've produced. But the music they use isn't even Watchtower's music. It's so-called worldly music. So I've bought the rights to use the same music, and I'm going to show as many of my subscribers and followers and Facebook friends as possible, showing witnesses that you can be happy and have a fulfilled, meaningful life outside Watchtower. So if you want to appear in part 9 of the Worst Convention Ever series, I will put instructions in a link below. Anyway, I hope you found this video interesting. Thank you for putting up with my ranting and rambling at Ken Flodin. And as always, thank you for watching.